Take your Bibles this morning, open to the book of Hebrews, if you will, Hebrews chapter 13. And this morning, I want to look at verses 7 down to verse 14 with you here this morning. And I want to preach about having spiritual immunity. That's really the title of our sermon. Now, over the past few weeks, we've heard about what's going on with this coronavirus, and there's a serious concern about it, and rightly so. I've been doing some reading about it this week, and of course, we know it began in China. And as of the reading I did, 83,000 people are known to be infected, and sadly, 2,800 deaths have been reported. And I was reading that the source of this began in a market in Wuhan where they sold both dead and live animals, and such markets pose a heightened risk of viruses jumping from animals to humans because of the hygiene standards that are difficult to maintain there. And so the reports are it's something that we need to be concerned about. It is something that is spreading. And the World Health Organization kind of gives some steps that we should take. I was reading on their website, wash your hands, maintain at least 3 feet distance between yourself and anyone who is coughing or sneezing. So if I don't hug some of you this morning, you'll understand why. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. And then one of the things they really emphasize is keep your immune system healthy. And they say by doing what you do to do that is to eat plenty of fruits, vegetables, whole grains, 30 minutes of exercise, make sure you're getting enough sleep and keeping up with your vaccines, and don't smoke and don't drink alcohol in order to keep your immune system up. And that's all good advice, and we need to follow that. This is something that is a big concern and is in the news. But I couldn't help but also make a parallel. May I suggest to you that there are also spiritual viruses that we need to be aware of? Just as there are many physical viruses out there that can damage the body, there are spiritual viruses that can damage the soul. And I'm speaking about the spiritual virus of false doctrine that can attack the body of Christ. Now, this is the concern of the writer of Hebrews as we come to Hebrews chapter 13. And I think the main idea is found in verse number 9. When you first read these verses here in this section of chapter 13, they kind of appear on the surface level as if they're kind of a bunch of disjointed and random verses. But there's a common theme, I believe, that ties them all together. And it's the idea that we see expressed in verse number 9. Look at verse 9. Be not carried about with divers and strange doctrines. This is the main idea, where he says, be not carried about. The force of that, that's an imperative in the Greek. If you've heard me preach before, you know I sometimes refer to verbs because they kind of carry the mail, so to speak, in a passage of Scripture. And if it's an imperative, that means it's a command. And so the idea is God is commanding us, don't be carried away. Don't be swept aside by strange and false doctrines. Now, this implies there's something that we can do to guard ourselves against these false teachings and doctrines that will arise. In fact, the verb here is a present imperative. It's what Greek scholars call a prohibition imperative. You say, what does that mean? Simply means this. It commands an action to stop that's already begun. In other words, in this community of believers, already there were some that were holding on to strange and false teachings and were in danger of being swept away, of this spiritual virus infecting them and their spiritual life being damaged. Now, let me just say, as a believer, you can never lose your salvation, amen? But you can be swept aside. There's other things that you can lose, and even true believers can be deceived. They can have their minds basically carried away into false teaching. And so this is the warning that he's giving. And so the thrust of the command is really like this. Stop being carried away. He calls them to guard themselves against these spiritual viruses, these false teachings and doctrines. We could say that this section of Scripture is kind of the CDC. It's the Center for Doctrinal Control here. He's trying to tell them, beware, guard yourself against these things. Now, with that in mind, what I want you to see in our passage today are 4 important ways that you can build your spiritual immunity against false doctrine and false teaching. And here's the first one. Number 1, realize false teaching is a continual danger. You know, awareness is half the battle, right? I've been reading about this coronavirus thing. Awareness is really a big part of it. You need to be aware. And you need to take steps because of this awareness. And this is what the writer here is telling us. You need to be aware that there are these strange false teachings that are out there. And he uses two words to describe them. Number one, diverse, which is a word that means manifold. It's really a Greek word that means multicolored. It was a word used to describe the skin of a leopard or the changing variations of the strain of music or a cloth that was embroidered with different colors. It's the idea of different colored, multicolored, different types of doctrines that have come around. And then also he uses the word strange. Look again at verse 9. With divers and strange doctrines. The word strange, xenos, this is the idea of something that is unfamiliar, foreign, alien, unheard of. Something that is new and unheard of. And this is what he's saying. There's these new, unheard of doctrines and teachings that are out there. Getting back to the illustration of the coronavirus, I read that was just one virus in a family of viruses. I even read that there are, according to the CDC, millions of different types of viruses out there. That's incredible when you think about that. But equally so in the spiritual world, there are all types, thousands and thousands of false teachings and false doctrines, and people are coming up with new teachings even today. Now, friend, you mark it down. If it's new, it's not true. And if it's true, it's not new. And for example, I was reading, did you know, just some new churches that are springing up. There's the Maradonian Church. You say, what is that? This is a church that was originated to worship Diego Maradona. You say, who is that? He's a soccer player. Yeah, that's shocking, isn't it? This church started in 1998. It has more than 1 million followers in 60 countries. They don't count years until beginning at 1960, which was the birth of this soccer player. So there's even a church that's worshiping a soccer player. Can you believe that? I don't know how he's going to get him into heaven. Maybe he's going to kick him there or something. I don't know. It's just ridiculous when you think about it. And then I was reading about another religion that started in 2008. It's called Jediism, and it's a religion based on Star Wars. It's the truth. They believe in the Force. You have to beware of the dark side. There have been incidents where when Jedis, supposed Jedis, have been evicted from public places because they refuse to take off their hood. And then there's another religion I read about that's relatively new. It's called Presbyterianism. Presbyterianism is this idea that when you die, your soul goes up to the roof and stays there. The soul stays stuck up there until someone knocks it down with a long pole and your new life begins. I'm not making this up. It's out there. So I guess we need to be careful when we change the lights from now on of people that might be there. You say, these are bizarre, way out, and you're right. But the truth of the matter is, those are not really the things that are the most dangerous. The most dangerous doctrines are the ones that are the closest to the truth. They have a lot of truth in it, and just a little bit of error, enough to pull you aside. They say that rat poison is made of 98% whole wheat and 2% poison. So we need to be alert. That's why Jude wrote in his epistle, that you should earnestly contend for the faith. Just realize that they're out there. Now, what doctrine was the writer of Hebrews dealing with? Well, look at verse number 9, where he says, for it is a good thing that the heart be established with grace, not with meats, which have not profited them that have been occupied therein. And so the writer is warning about some strange new doctrine, which like a virus was beginning to infect the church. And we're not really sure what this new teaching was about. Evidently, it was in regard to something about meat, some meaningless rule about meat that was leading people away from the message of salvation by grace. And so he was saying, you need to be aware of that. Beware. Realize it's out there, that it can take you away from the message of grace. Any teaching or idea that robs you of the grace of God, friend, you need to be aware of that. You need to be careful about that. So realize that they're out there. But then he gives a second thing. Number two, imitate the faith of godly leaders. Go back to chapter 13. go back to verse number 7. Notice what he says, "Remember them which have the rule over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation." Now, here in verse number 7, notice he talks about the word conversation, their lifestyle. That's a word that means just literally that, their lifestyle. And scholars agree that the author here is referring to past leaders who have died. He's saying, remember godly leaders that are no longer with us. Remember their life. Remember how their end of their life, how they stayed faithful to the end. Remember how they lived and what they taught. And again, this word here, remember, is an imperative. This is not a suggestion. This is a command from God where he says, remember their life. Now, in verse number 7, I believe he's referring to people that have already gone to heaven. He'll talk about rulers. Look in verse number 17, for example, of chapter 13. Obey them that have the rule over you. And then again in verse number 24, salute all them that have the rule over you. There, I think, in verses 17 and 24, he's referring to current leaders. In verse number 7, he's referring to those that are already have gone. They've already finished their course. And he's commanding them, remember them. And then he says in verse number 7, whose faith follow. Look at the word follow there. Interesting Greek word. It's where we get our word mimic. A mime is the literal Greek word, mime o my, where we get the word mimic. And he's saying, just mimic their faith. So there's two commands here. Remember them. And then number 2, mimic their faith. Just do what they did. Live the way they lived. Look at their life. And you know, I got to be honest with you, when I read a verse like this, I can't help but immediately think of the people that have been an influence in my life. And the first person that stands out is Pastor Johnson. I kind of remember him. I'll be honest with you, I miss Pastor Johnson. We know he's in heaven rejoicing with the Lord, going on to his reward. We're here, we're still laboring. And you know, sometimes I just need to remember him, remember his faithfulness, remember the life that he lived, and then also to imitate him. Now, this isn't hard for me because some of you know I grew up here at Grace, and when I was 15 years old, my first position here, I was a janitor of the church, and I just cleaned, you know, and so I was here all the time. I was literally here all the time from morning till evening. We had a Christian school that started back then. Someone this week slipped under my door a picture of the first year we had a Christian school. It had all the students lined up, and I'm in that picture, and I will not show it to you. But it made me think back those years when all this started, and I was the janitor of the church, and I was always hanging around, and I had the opportunity to watch the life of Pastor Johnson, and of course, I learned under him. I learned his teaching, and I remember on Sunday nights after church, I would prepare the buildings for school the next morning, which means I cleaned out the auditorium, and Pastor Johnson had this habit of leaving his Bible on the pulpit with his notes still in there. And I would go up and I would always open the Bible and read through all of his notes. And then when no one was around, I think I told you this before, I would preach the sermon with his notes that he preached that morning and that night. And I always thought I did a better job preaching that sermon than he did. I was just imitating him, imitating his life. And I think about all the things that he gave me. He gave me my first job. He gave me the first opportunity to preach. He's taught me so much. And when I read a verse like this where the writer is saying, look, in this world in which you live today, remember those godly leaders and then imitate them. If I can just imitate and be like him, I think I'd be pretty happy. And if I can just get you to live as faithful to the Lord as he was, I think we all would be better off. We all would be happy in it. And he's saying here in the context of guarding you against false teachings, remember those godly teachers that taught you the orthodox way, that taught you the word of God. Don't depart from that. Remember them. And that's what his advice is here. You know, I was thinking about when, some of you know next year we're going to have a seminary meeting on our church campus. And when this was proposed to me, I was asked to be the president of the seminary for the seminary to move here on our campus. I met immediately with our deacons because I don't want to do anything that's not the will of the Lord. And many times I'll go to them and I'll get their advice. And by the way, thank God for the godly deacons that we have. They're godly, good men. And I just have so much confidence in their wisdom. And I brought this to them and I said, here's what the proposal is. And they didn't know this, but I went into that meeting thinking if one person had a hesitation about it, if there's one flag that's raised about it, we're just not going to do it. There has to be total unity about this whole idea. And I presented this whole thing to our deacons, and one of the deacons spoke up, and you know what they said? They said, you know what, Pastor Johnson taught us that if a need is placed in front of you and you have the ability to meet that need, it constitutes a call from God. And after that, the decision was over with pretty much because there was total agreement and unity there that this is something that we should do. So even there, you know, pastor's still teaching us. And so we're thankful for those godly leaders. But then here's the next thing. Not only do we realize the false teaching is a continual danger and imitate the faith of godly leaders, but here's the third thing. Hold firmly to the centrality of Christ. Look at verse number 8. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now, this seems out of context, but I believe the author put it here in a somewhat abrupt manner to make a point. You say, what's his point? Here's the point. Godly teachers come and go, but Jesus Christ remains the same forever. Godly teachers will come and go, but Jesus is the same forever. And so sometimes people can become so enamored with some godly man and his teaching that when they're gone, they're devastated and they don't continue on in the faith. And friend, that's not the way we should live as Christians. The author does not diminish the value of sound teachers, but he's saying that after godly leaders and teachers die, just remember, Jesus remains the same. Jesus is the same. He's unchanging. If you had a godly teacher or leader in your life that taught you and is no longer here, just remember this, Jesus Christ is still here. And he's the one that we serve. And he's the one that we worship. And so we're not supposed to fall apart because Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we are to focus on his cross, the cross of Christ. Look at verse number 10. Notice what it says. We have an altar whereof they have no right to eat which serve the tabernacle. And look at verse 11. For the bodies of those beasts whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest for sin are burned without the camp. Verse 12. Wherefore Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered without the gate. Now, what does this mean? These verses are not easy to understand, but let me just summarize the overall point that he's trying to make. What he's trying to say simply is that and this is the truth that he's repeated several times throughout this letter, and that is Jesus is superior to all the Jewish sacrificial animals. He's superior to that system because Jesus fulfilled that. All of those Old Testament sacrifices pointed to Jesus Christ and the cross. And so they were the shadow. Jesus is the substance. They all pointed to the work of the cross. Now, there were Jews that were trying to draw Hebrew Christians back into Judaism. And what they were saying is, we still have an altar in the temple. We can still go to the temple. We can still go to the altar where there are sacrifices made. You Christians, you say that Christianity is superior to Judaism. You don't even have an altar that you can go to. We have an altar. You don't. And the writer of Hebrews answers it by saying, we do have an altar. Look at verse 10. We have an altar whereof they have no right to eat which serve the tabernacle. He's saying this, we have an altar, and furthermore, those of you that are still in Judaism or have turned back into Judaism, you have no right to come to our altar and eat. Now, why does he say and eat? Because did you know in the Old Testament, some of those Old Testament Jewish sacrifices, you can actually partake by eating part of it? For example, there was the free will offering, where if something good happened to you and you wanted to give thanks to God, you would take your animal to the altar. A third of the animal was given to the sacrifice. A third of the meat was given to the high priest. And then a third of the meat you took home to yourself where you shared it with your family and you had a Thanksgiving meal. So you can eat some of the sacrifices at the altar. That's what he's referring to here. However, there was one sacrifice that you couldn't eat. It was the sacrifice of the sin offering. When the sin offering was given, you would take the blood of the animal, sprinkle it on the mercy seat, and then the whole body of the animal, the whole carcass, was taken outside the camp, and it was completely burned. That was the sin offering. And the writer points to Jesus in that, because look what he says in verse number 11. For the bodies of those beasts whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest for sin and are burned without the camp. Look at verse 12. Wherefore Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people whose own blood, who with his own blood suffered without the gate. What is he saying? Did you know that when Jesus was crucified, he was crucified outside the city of Jerusalem? He was taken outside the camp, just like the sin offering in the Old Testament. So he's saying all of that points to Jesus. Jesus was crucified outside the camp. And there's a sense in which the cross is our altar, where Christ was crucified. And just like Old Testament saints could partake of the sacrifice, they could eat and be nourished by the sacrifice. In a spiritual way, we go to the cross and we are nourished spiritually by the sacrifice of Christ, who was crucified outside the camp. He was the sin offering for our sin. And so the point is, and why, there's one phrase I don't want you to miss in verse number 13, where it says, let us go forth unto him without the camp, bearing his reproach. Actually, back up to verse 11. For the bodies of those beasts whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest for sin are burned. And then verse 12. Wherefore, Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood. And that's the thing I want you to see. The word sanctify here refers to cleansing from sin at the time of salvation. So his whole point is that Jesus and his death on the cross is our altar. That altar is far superior to any Jewish altar. We go to that altar. We're cleansed by Christ at the cross. And there's a sense in which we still feed on him spiritually. We're nourished by his sacrifice. So he's pointing completely to the cross of Christ. You see, that's how you're immune against false teaching. You focus on the cross of Jesus. You focus on everything that Jesus did for you on the cross. And then focus on the call in verse 13. Let us go forth therefore unto him without the camp, bearing his reproach. The writer's saying, let's go outside the camp where Christ is. Now, to the original reader, the message is clear. You have to leave Judaism to follow Christ. You have to leave all that stuff behind and go outside the camp. This is the call of salvation. If you haven't done that, go outside the camp where Christ is, where he was crucified for you. Find cleansing, find forgiveness for your sins. Stop holding on to your old life. Go outside the camp where Jesus is, the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is where we are saved. And friend, any teaching that draws you away from the cross of Christ, you better beware of that. You better beware of that. There's even Christianity out there that doesn't include the cross. I say Christianity, quote unquote Christianity. It's not real Christianity if it doesn't focus on the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, the cross of Christ. And so hold firmly, he's saying, to the centrality of Christ. Realize false teaching is a danger. Imitate the faith of godly leaders. Hold firmly to the cross of Christ. And let me give you the last thing he says. Look at verse 14. For here have we no continuing city, but we seek one to come. And this is the fourth thing. Focus on the promise of heaven. And the idea here is linked with being a reproach for Christ. If you hold on to the cross, you'll have to bear the reproach. Because remember, when you hold to the truth and you hold to the cross of Christ, you have to remember that there's an offense in the gospel. The world doesn't want to hear about the cross of Jesus. They don't understand how a person dying on a cross can change their life today. So a lot of times the world will look at us as if we're fools. We're crazy to believe in all of that. There's a reproach. But that's all right. I don't mind bearing the reproach with Christ. That's the idea. I'll go outside the camp and I'll bear the reproach. Why? Because I know that my reward is not here on earth. My reward is in heaven. There's a continuing city there. And I think there's a sense in which, again, the people in Judaism were trying to say to those Hebrew Christians, you don't even have a continuing city. You don't have an altar. You don't have a continuing city. And the writer's saying, oh, yeah, we do have an altar. It's called the cross of Christ, where we're continually fed. And we do have a city. There's no continuing city on earth. Now, I think the Jews in Judaism, they boasted about Jerusalem, that city that has been there so long. And they're saying, you don't have a continuing city. And he's saying, yeah, we do. There's no continuing city on earth, but we have one that is to come. The only city that is eternal is the New Jerusalem. It is heaven. That's where you're going to get your reward. Don't expect rewards down here on earth. It's okay to bear the reproach of the gospel, to bear the reproach for standing for what is true and holding to the truth. That's okay. Don't expect rewards here. Your reward is in that city that's there in heaven, that city to come. And so focus on the promises of heaven. And if you do these things, you will build a spiritual immunity against false doctrine that's out there. Now, you don't have to know every little bit about every false teaching that's out there. You just need to do these things. Hold to the cross, my dear friend. Hold to the message of salvation by grace. Hold to that continuing city in heaven that we're all going to go to one day. Imitate the faith of godly leaders that have gone on before you. Follow in their footsteps. And if you do those things, you'll be all right. You don't need to know about every nuance of all these new teachings that are out there. I heard about one editor of a magazine. His name was William White. He received many articles from writers, but he returned most of them with rejection slips. So one writer was very disappointed that his article was returned, and he wrote to him and said, Mr. White, you sent back a story of mine. I know you didn't read it because as a test, I pasted together pages 19 and 20 in the manuscript, and when the manuscript was returned, those pages were not torn apart, so I know you didn't read it. And the editor wrote back a brief reply. He said, Dear sir, at breakfast when I open an egg, I don't need to eat all of it to determine if it's bad. That's so very true. You don't need to wade through all the religious writings in the world to know if they're good or if they're bad. You just need to ask this question. What does it say about Jesus? What does it say about the cross? What does it teach about the way of salvation? And don't allow yourself to be carried away or infected with these strange teachings and doctrines that are out there. Let your heart be established by the grace of God. Let's bow for prayer together today. And so, Father, we are duly warned. And I pray if there's someone here today that may be dabbling in other ideas, other religions, so to speak, other teachings that would subvert their soul and pull them away from the grace that is in Christ Jesus, Lord, that they would be warned today to turn away from those things, to not allow themselves to be drawn away by some force. Help them, Lord, to do what this writer of Hebrews is telling us. Remember the godly teaching that they have received from godly leaders and imitate their life. Hold firmly to Jesus Christ. Focus on heaven. Lord, may we take this to heart. And if there's someone here today that's never been to the cross for salvation, they've never gone outside the camp, they've never knelt at the cross, I pray that they'll find salvation today. And friends, with heads bowed and eyes closed, I want to give you the opportunity right where you are to put your faith in Christ. He's outside the camp. He's waiting there for you. Will you go? Would you leave the old things of your life, those old beliefs that have kept you back, the old lifestyle that's hindering you from coming to salvation? And would you turn to Christ? Would you walk outside the camp, kneel before Christ and say, Jesus, I'm trusting you and you alone as my only salvation. You are the way, the truth, and the life. And I put my full faith in you, Lord Jesus. Friend, if you'll pray that, if you'll just do that, if you'll put your faith in Jesus, he will forgive you for your sin. He will give you peace. He'll give you eternal life. And friend, would you do that if you haven't already? How many with heads bowed and eyes closed say, yes, today, preacher, I make that decision. I'm putting my full faith in Christ. Would you raise your hand? I want to pray for you. I don't want to embarrass you, but I want to pray for you. I put my full faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, thank you for the faith that you give us even to trust you. Bless today these words to hearing hearts. And we pray in Jesus' wonderful, matchless name.